Welcome to the review slides of personality and personality assessment. Once again, these are not meant as an exhaustive list of things that might be on the test, more of a quick overview of some of the main points from the lectures. I, as always, strongly encourage you to use the study guide, the textbooks, and the full lectures as you study for this test. So I'm going to briefly just kind of review what we talked about as far as personality and personality assessment. So again, a reminder that personality is an individual's unique constellation of psychological traits that is relatively stable over time. And the measurement of personality has been a major part of psychometrics. So again, we're in a test on psychological tests and measurements. And whenever we're using psychological tests, we're trying to basically quantify the differences between people. So personality is one way that we can quantify differences between people. And personality traits, then, are any distinguishable, relatively enduring way in which one individual varies from another. So think of them as individual constructs within personality. And each personality theory is going to have basically posit different constructs or personality traits. We're most familiar with the big five, probably the five big personality traits. But again, each one, each different test may have different personality traits that it tries to measure. And what makes a personality trait is that it's distinguishable. So it's basically different from other traits. It's relatively enduring. In other words, it is a stable part of someone's personality or the way they behave. And it allows us to differentiate people in a meaningful way from each other. Personality types refer to a constellation of traits that is similar in pattern to one identified category of personalities within a taxonomy of personalities. And taxonomy just means kind of a structure. So, for instance, when we talk about type A versus type B personalities, that isn't saying that pretty much all you need to know about someone's personality is whether they're type A or type B. But it also means that it's a constellation of traits. So a type A personality, for instance, is probably very high on conscientiousness, but they're also high on a need to achieve. They're also probably a little bit neurotic. So that's a constellation of traits that results in a personality type. So just kind of a brief review of the origins of personality and personality measurement. Basically, the idea of initial trait conception. So early research on personality basically looked at personality as what kind of adjectives or descriptors that language had already come up with to basically define traits of personality. So the word conscientiousness, the word agreeable, the word happy, the word sad, the word mean, the word aggressive, all of those can be adjectives which describe a person and a person's personality. So initial measurements of individual differences tried to look at all these traits, and as this was being done, it was quickly recognized that there was literally hundreds of words in the English language that allow us to differentiate between people on personality traits. So the real challenge for the measurement of personality was to get these down into clusters of behaviors that made sense to actually make it more manageable for us to talk about personality, for us to measure personality, and also for those measures to have some kind of meaningful prediction of actual eventual behaviors. In other words, we want to be able to measure personality for a couple of factors. We want to be able to define what is normal and abnormal behavior within a culture so that we can actually assist people if their personality is resulting in them not necessarily functioning well in the society that they exist in. But we also want to be able to predict future behavior from personality. So Cattell's factor analytic trait theory was one of the first ones, the 16PF, basically found surface and source traits. And this is our first kind of summing down from those hundreds of descriptive traits into constructs. And Cattell's factor had 16 personality factors. Eisenach's trait dimensional theory basically said that we can divide people into four broad categories of constructs that all interact with each other: introverted versus extroverted, emotionally stable versus neurotic. And then finally, another theory of trait conception is the Big Five, so the five-factor model, that basically said there's five core dimensions of behavior, and each one incorporates a lot of those various other descriptors. And the Big Five, of course, is neuroticism, extroversion, openness to experience, agreeableness, and conscientiousness. We also talked about objective versus projective measures methods. So with each one of these lectures, by the way, when we're going through them, I'm not going to be going through every individual test. I'm going to be talking them on a more broad level. That doesn't mean that you don't need to know some of the dimensions, especially looking at the study guide, of each individual personality test, each individual clinical test, each individual vocational test. But these lectures are going to be going more into the overall kind of big picture of each of these subjects. So when we're talking about personality measurement, we have to kind of quantify or categorize the test into two broad categories. The first is objective measures. They're typically administered by paper and pencil or computer. There are a bunch of short answer items, and they're used to assess the assessee's task is to select one response from those provided. So it's a direct measure of personality. People are being asked questions that are related to personality. They're providing answers, which are then scored. And then those scores provide us data that we can actually validate. So this is kind of traditional measurement. If we have 10 items that we think all measure aggressiveness, we then determine, are they all interrelated, so inter-rater reliability, because we have actual scores, so we can statistically look at that. But then we can ask, do people that rate high on this scale of aggressiveness, are they also more aggressive? Are they more likely to get into fights? Are they more likely to verbally abuse people? Are they more likely to end up being arrested? And if we find all that evidence, that convergent evidence, we start to make an argument that we actually know that this is indeed a valid measure of that personality. We also have projective methods. The individual supplies structure to unstructured stimuli in a manner consistent with the unique owner's personality. And this is an indirect measure. And the idea behind this was, and this is coming from kind of psychiatry, early clinical psychology, and kind of Freudian viewpoints, that the personality is not something that we really understand well, that it's mainly being manifested through unconscious drives, and then therefore the only way to truly measure personality is through an indirect measure. Now, the problem with these projective measures is they're very subjective, which means that there is no standard way to measure them. It's hard to actually put any kind of statistical validation on them. We can basically go, well, what are the interpretations that people are making, and do those interpretations actually result in successful diagnoses, for instance? So if you see an ink blot and that the coding guide says that if you see a spider, that means that you're aggressive, we can then ask, are people that see spiders in that ink blot more likely to be aggressive? And in most cases, when attempts have been made to actually validate projective measures, there's been very little evidence that they are consistently and successfully predicting of behavior. And that's really what we're after. So coming back to those objective tests, we already talked about personality tests like the Big Five, so kind of self-report. There's also criterion keyed objective tests, and they're kind of in between the two. So the idea of why you'd want a projective test, so like the ink blot test, is the idea that personality is sometimes unknown by the person that actually has it, that it's driven by unconscious drives. But there's also kind of a belief that the projective tests are harder for people to fake. It's harder for people to know what actually is a right or wrong response. Compared to the objective tests, like the Big Five, that are all based on direct questions of personality, which are very easy often to tell, especially if you know what theory you're being tested under, what each question is actually answering. Basically, if you know about the Big Five and its five factors, you can look at almost any Big Five factor test and basically just go through and mark which each question is measuring. So a way to try to both provide a validatable scale, so a scale that provides numbers that we can then validate on performance, but also isn't as obvious or direct as the Big Five tests and those other trait-based tests, is the criterion keyed objective tests. So these are objective. They're made usually to discriminate between normal and abnormal behavior, and they're based on the idea of empirical criterion keying. And the idea behind this is that you just create an enormous number of questions that are not necessarily related directly to personality, but then you give them to people that are in a criterion group. So basically, if you're wanting to find out which questions predict whether someone or not is aggressive, you get a bunch of questions, and then you give all of those questions to people that are known to be very non-aggressive and to a group that's known to be very aggressive. And then you simply look through all of the items and find which ones do they differ the most on. You then use those to predict aggression. So the biggest and best example of this is the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, often referred to as the MMPI, developed in the 1920s, has 567 true and false self-report items. It's gone through a lot of revisions. There was some bias issues. The last revision was in 1989, but it does have several subtests. And the big advantage to this, and the sell of this, in fact, is that a lot of times it's hard to tell what the items are supposed to be measuring, but there is empirical evidence, there's statistical evidence, that they are, in fact, valid predictors. We can also look at specific domain tests, so beyond tests that are made to broadly measure personality, like the MMPI, like the Big Five, and also like those projective tests. We also have a lot of specific dimension tests or specific domain tests. Academic motivation scale, so how motivated are you to perform academically? That is a personality trait. Beck depression inventory scale, so how likely you are to be depressed or not. Math anxiety scale, loneliness scale, so locus of control, whether you have an internal locus of control or external locus of control. A lot of these, they're not meant to measure all personality or all factors of personality. They're made to measure individual parts of our attitudes and our personality. We can also use behavioral assessment to infer personality. So in this case, we're not necessarily trying to measure the personality. We're trying to go more directly for the actual behaviors. Because when we measure personality, for example, when we're measuring conscientiousness, why we measure conscientiousness is we assume that people are more conscientious. They're going to behave in a more conscientious manner. So some behavioral personality measurement has gone more of a behavioral assessment route, basically looking at the antecedents of behavior, the behaviors themselves, and the cognitions behind them, so the ABCs of behaviors. And this often involves cognitive interviewing, personal introspection, and diaries. There's not necessarily an inference to personality, but this is kind of an approach, more of a cognitive approach sometimes, that's looking at and a behavioral approach. Instead of trying to predict the personality, let's go directly for the behaviors that we're inferring from the personality without necessarily inferring back to a construct of personality. So we kind of talked about the projective test a little bit. Again, a projective test employs a standard set of ambiguous stimuli. So these can be ink blots, they can be word completion stems, so basically sentences that are half done and you have to finish the sentences. They can be drawings, pictures that you have to put a story to, and the idea is that responses are reflections of unconscious processes. The responses on scoring are often not standardized, and most efforts to make standardizations for these tests have not met with much success. And what I mean by much success is that once a standardization comes out, so there is, for example, standards for scoring the Rorschach's test, the ink blots. However, when we actually have people use those standards and then ask, does their actual predictions of someone's behavior based on this test actually result in a validatable result? In other words, if 20 different clinicians hear the same, see the same interpretation and score it the same, does that scoring then actually predict future behavior? And again, most of the studies indicate that it does not. The test must be evaluated by trained clinical psychologists, so you need someone that has been well trained on the test to have any kind of validity whatsoever. And in fact, using these tests without a trained clinician can often be damaging and harmful, and studies have proven that, that basically trying to just grab a bunch of ink blots and have a person just try to make some interpretations can often give the person information that is actually harmful. Common projective tests include the ink blot test, the thematic appreciation test, where you're looking at pictures, projective drawing, so just having someone give someone a blank sheet of paper and have them drawing either a house, a tree, another person, different people, sentence completion, and also some sorting of arrangement of picture tests. So the general problems of these projective tests, poor reliability, and what I mean by poor reliability is even with standardized scoring, if you have a subject go into three different trained clinicians and give the exact same responses on one of these tests, they'll often get very different actual diagnoses or very different reports of what their personality is like. As I said, very poor validity. So once we have, even if we have reliability, so you manage to come up with a standardized set of scores that everyone agrees on. So we have that person go into three different clinicians. They get the same personality read from that test from all three of them. We then ask, does that actually personality read predict future behavior? And the answer generally is no. Most of these tests don't have a standardized scoring. And studies have found that a lot of times the bigger predictor of how someone is interpreted in these tests is not the person, it's the therapist themselves and their projections upon how they interpret the people's interpretations. So why are these still used? Long-held stereotypes, so they are considered, many people almost expect to see these kind of tests when they come and see a clinician or a psychiatrist. The interpretations sometimes seem to make a certain amount of sense, so there's some face validity to them. And there has been some studies that, though not very useful for prediction or for actually categorizing or diagnosing people, that they are occasionally useful in a broad set of tools for therapy.